Can hear me, right?
Yes. Good afternoon. Welcome everybody to the IMSC Algebraic Combinatorics Seminar. It's a great pleasure to have our alumnus, Krishnan Rajkumar, who's now at JNU, and he's going to talk about Selberg integral and combinatorial connections. Krishnan.
Hey, thanks a lot, Amri and Vishwanath. Yeah, if it wasn't for you, I wouldn't have brought up this stuff for you to peruse. I hope this talk won't be as bad as I visualize it, but thanks a lot for giving me this opportunity. Why? Because I always think that in a couple of weeks I would have polished it, but Vishwanath knows it has been several years. But there's nothing that you have missed. Whatever I'm speaking about, I didn't know till a few weeks back, so it's always best to delay as much as possible. Thanks a lot. And yeah, IMSC, I really miss the coffee table discussions and yeah, the huge seminar hall. God knows when I will come along to meet you guys. But yeah, this is the best we can do. Thanks a lot. So let me just quickly start. Now, the Selberg integral. So there's a huge history about the Selberg integral. I thought I'll just, for the sake of it, read out, I'll paraphrase what Warnar has mentioned in a couple of years back in a paper. So he said, this is an integral which was hugely overlooked for at least the first 30 or 40 years of its existence after it was proved, basically. And of course, now more than 70 years later, seems to have become the most important, most fundamental and most important hypergeometric integral ever. And it has applications in, so he has mentioned several fields, but I will just say random matrices, probability theory, constant term identities. The list is endless. It has somehow found its way into too many areas that we seem to want to know more about it. So for the time being, let me just start by defining. Sorry, I never stick to the line, but without the line, it would be a mess. So let me just. So this is the way it is defined. It's a multivariate integral, and it's, let's say, our variables pi. So this is one way in which one can write, and there's this delta t. I'll just define it in a bit. A modulus sign, let me just put a modulus sign, because we're going to raise it to some complex power. So what are we? So this is the integral in which the way in which Selberg defined it. It was a generalization of the Euler's beta integral to start with. So we'll come to that in a bit for case one, n equal one. So initially, at least in this region where, let's say, real alpha is bigger than one, real beta bigger than one, and of course, there are several ways in which one can go about it. These are analytic number, these are complex numbers. So overall, it's a function of several complex variables. So, and I am not so comfortable with it. Let me just, suppose we fix alpha and beta, then gamma has these possibilities. Real gamma should definitely be greater than, let's say, the maximum among several things, like one minus one by n is an option, and minus real alpha by n minus one. The same for beta also. This has a nice symmetry with respect to alpha and beta, which we would exploit for the rest of the talk. This is one way in which we could specify the initial conditions. So what is Selberg's big result? So He says that
one
it's, pardon?
Just one question: the t is it like a is this a vector integral? Is t a?
Oh, sorry, t dt by dt. I just mean dt one dt. Dt is, let's say, I'll just put a bar below t. It means it's a it's a n variables t one to t n, and we are having a normal Lebesgue measure, and this is a proper integral. Improper integral, if you wish, but as of now, it's all proper if these conditions are assumed. And what is Selberg's result? So this is a very nice, beautiful formula, is what he understood it as. He derived it as n minus one. And there are even better ways of writing this, but somehow it's not suitable for our. I was preferring this. So if we had chosen, instead of alpha minus one, we had written alpha, it would have been slightly more ugly to see. This is like kind of the best it gets, say plus one, sorry, by, this is something in terms of alpha plus beta plus n minus 1 plus j gamma, and this is just a 1 plus gamma. So we could think of these in one league and this in another. So of course, alpha and beta, there's a symmetry, and that's it. It can't get even more beautiful than this. So it's a generalization of Euler's integral, which is the case when n equal to 1. And this, it becomes the Euler's beta integral. Is it Euler? Sorry. It's with the beta integral. I think it's Euler, yes. And it evaluates to the simple form. So this discriminant I didn't mention, so I should mention it first only. Maybe I'll write it by this side, because it will be useful for the rest of the talk. So discriminant, or the delta t, is actually product I less than j over all the indices I less than j t I minus t j. To write it either way, but we will write it this way. So this is the discriminant, and of course, when n is 1, it's empty. We take it to be 1. So it turns out to be a simple beta integral, which has this simple, it was even more simple. It's almost like generalization of our combinatorial coefficient won by that. So in analytic terms. So a point to be mentioned is, it's like most analytic functions, you start out with an integral which is defined in a certain range, which converges in a certain range, and we get this formula. But then this formula itself is a function, defines a function, and not only in this range, but in outside it also. So it would be like meromorphic, but it can be continued meromorphically to the entire complex plane. If you just fix gamma, if you fix alpha and beta and let gamma vary, and so on, it's several variables. Already a little puzzling, but the formula is so good. Now,
so in the n equals one case, there is no gamma at all.
And there is gamma. I'm sorry, what did you say?
There's no gamma at
all. This other gamma. Yes, there's no gamma. It doesn't come up.
And now, because of this multivariable thing, you're able to introduce this new parameter gamma.
Yes. In fact, that's what gives it its power also, it seems. But now, if somebody were to sing the paeans to the beta integral, they might have several talks to give. At least the Selberg integral does seem to appear in several things.
Beta thing comes in probability theory also, right? When you take uniform 0, 1 things. And
yes, of course. So the same sort of thing, probability theory, generalizations of whatever you said comes up here also. There are multivariate distributions where this sort of integrand and variations. So there are several variations. Those are the variations which appear in all those fields I was saying. Hyperplane arrangement was something I missed. More cutting edge research seems to depend on, used to depend, at least still depends on Selberg integral. Okay, so what's his proof? So, I mean, this is the way in which I, so sorry, but.
Try tilting the tablet a bit.
Yeah. Tilting?
The tablet.
Oh, I see.
No, I have the same problem, yeah. The lines.
Okay, sure. Thanks. Well, where are we? So, as by way of history, I will just keep on having several proofs, but in the very beginning, we will complete all our complete proofs. Rest all will be sketches or conjectures or whatever I have mentioned in the abstract. So, 94 is the published proof, but he seems to have had it with him since 41 at least, and he was very hesitant to publish it, and because he thought it was it must have been done earlier, but yeah, till 70s nobody even knew that it existed. Even they didn't suspect such a formula would happen. So what's his proof? So this is why I'm talking about his proof, because it's in theme of this seminar. Symmetric functions come up. So what does he say? He first assumes that gamma is a positive integer, and he expresses this power, which is a nice symmetric function in T, polynomial, symmetric polynomial, as a sum over m lambda. And I obviously not define this in this talk. So I'll be happily using m lambda, e lambda, s lambda, etc. But we will define our Jack polynomials very deep in detail. So lambdas are actually going to be, they're permutations of. Or let's just put it this way. I have erased. How do I get back? The Zoom guy comes in between.
Just move it.
Pardon?
Just you can just move it out usually.
Move it out. I can? Yeah, I will. Thanks.
You can move it to the top or something.
Move it to the side somewhere. Oh, top, bottom. Bottom is there. It goes down. So, lambda is a partition. So this is the part where I really wanted to highlight to you the proof of Selberg. This is Selberg's original proof, and extremely interesting. Many of his later proofs are kind of variations on them. So it's n into n minus 1, literally, into gamma. So this is the degree of this polynomial. It's homogeneous. And lambdas seems to be, the m lambdas come out, which are all partitions of the same thing. There's some additional conditions. This is what Selberg points out. Either lambda I, the ith largest part, is has some bounds to n minus I minus 1 gamma. Gamma? Oops, what happened? You can see it.
Lambda I less than or equal to 2n minus I minus 1.
Is all you can see? Why am I not able to write? Have I pressed something by mistake? Oma, what's this? Vishwanath.
Just click on that pencil icon again.
Pencil. Oh. Someone else is. Is it? No. Fine, let's just see once again. In fact, this screen is gone out of. Mm-hmm. You can still see it, right?
Yeah, we can now see it. It's become bigger.
Could have been better that way?
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. No. Sorry. What you just did now was better. Yeah.
Okay. I hope I am able to write now. Yes. So 2n minus I, that was a gamma there. And here it was lambda I is bigger than n minus I gamma. So there are some nice restrictions. So this lower bound is here obtained by induction, but this one is slightly more easy to derive by just looking at the degrees. Okay, so now just using this, what does he conclude? So he is able to, this is the, let's say, ingenuity of Selberg, that instead of looking and bothering about these C lambdas, he just goes on to what is our integral. The eventual integral, after you combine everything, turns out to be. So a function, let me just put it this way. If you just bother about, so he takes out this product somehow and says that whatever is left is going to be a constant function of alpha and beta. Where are we? So what we're trying to say, we are trying to say that if you just integrate m lambda with your original the weight function, which was whatever was left was only t to the alpha minus 1 and 1 minus t i to the, maybe I missed that I at that point. It's the product over I. There is an I there. So this becomes just a product of a lot of beta integrals. And eventually, what happens is if you take out this product by a subtle argument over the degrees, etc., he concludes that whatever is left should be a constant in alpha and beta. It's literally only dependent on gamma. And finally, what does he say? So he is also able to obtain a recurrence for this in terms of one plus gamma c n minus one of gamma. So he got a very beautiful recurrence, and this was just elementary calculus. He took a limit. I'll not write it down, but this was elementary calculus by letting alpha tend to minus one. So alpha minus one was a pole of this, but he's able to take a limit by multiplying by one plus alpha, etc. And that gives us this beautiful recurrence. So we'll need to use it in the next step. That's why I've written it down here. Eventually, putting it all together, you do get the evaluation. So this is not over yet. Actually, this evaluation was only known for gamma as an integer. So one needs to go on to the complex version of gamma. How do you arrange it? So Selberg uses what is called Carlson's theorem, or he invented his own theorem. He was not aware of Carlson's theorem probably, but it's all Mittag-Leffler type of identities where you say that a function, so let me just set it down. So Carlson's theorem. So this is a hardcore analytic result that he has used. So if you have a function which is analytic in real z greater than zero in some half plane, and even in that half plane, as z tends to infinity, its order, its exponential growth, or we call it order, etc., where this order is less than pi. Extremely interesting that one fixed number, if fz was smaller than this order, and fn is zero for all n in, let's say, positive integers. So if you are able to specify the value of function on positive integers by some formula or the other, and we also know that its growth is not too much, then that implies that the function is identically zero in that region or whatever analytic function. This is what Karlsson's theorem is. So the counterexample. Sorry.
Krishna, I don't understand this. O of e to the.
Some constant, let's say R, if you want to call it R, I wrote theta. Theta is some constant number.
And that zeta has to be less than the ratio of the circumference of a square.
Yes. That pi plays a very important role. And what is the counterexample to that? Is sine of pi z. Sine of pi z vanishes on the integers, but its order is 5 mod z. That's the first counterexample. The unusual theorem used in transcendence a lot, and Selberg uses it here. But yeah, most people didn't like the use of it in such a simple integral. So they have been looking for ways to circumvent Karlsson's theorem. You don't seem to like it either.
I'm just intrigued.
Okay. Yeah, it is an intriguing
sort of thing. Caught me by surprise that zeta less than pi somehow.
In fact, Palu sir will have a lot more to say. There are so many such varieties. Even the 1941 paper of Selberg proves something somewhat of this sort only. So they were
had a mark. Actually, Ramanujan proved a certain theorem, which was called Ramanujan's master theorem from Hardy, where he was trying to evaluate certain definite integrals.
Okay.
Where this theorem of Karlsson plays an important role.
Okay. So it does come up in evaluation.
Yeah.
Well designed for that. But nowadays people try to avoid the use of this in the Selberg integral theory. So this is why I presented the next proof, which is supposed to be, so this was 1944. And then we come to Aomoto. As I've told you, the paper was written in some math teacher's journal in Norwegian. So very few people even got to know of it. And Selberg himself mentioned it to Bombieri when it seemed to be of relevance in the late 70s. So anyway, Aomoto in 87, so this year seems to be special for our talk. Anyway, Aomoto came up with another proof, which is supposedly, maybe the first elementary version. Elementary means avoiding the use of analytic theorems as we mentioned. So if we just define it, just a new integral. Okay. So this is the same. Oops, one, n. And instead of just leaving it as it is, we have ek of t, the elementary symmetric function in k variables. Sorry. Okay, I'll write it down here. I thought I will never define it, but I'm myself blabbing. I1, I2, ik less than n and greater than 1, ti1, ti2. So product of k of these n variables, all possible products. That's elementary symmetry. And we still have our same weight only, so which I will now call alpha, beta, gamma, t. So the weight is, as you have seen in the past, product. I'm not sure. Wherever I'm at. Yeah, this one. Product ti alpha minus 1, 1 minus ti beta minus 1, delta t. So if we were to just fix our attention to where ek has gotten involved in the integrand, then how do we proceed? How does Aomoto proceed? So he has this very nice method. So I wanted to bring it to your attention, as well as it will be useful for us in the rest. It's 25 minutes, mama. Okay, so we start with saying ek plus 1. So whatever with the arguments is. So how does he prove this? I will just give a brief. Alpha plus n minus k plus, oh sorry, minus 1. Alpha plus beta I mean, I'm just going to write it. I should have prepared. Okay. This is a plus, not a plus one. I'm scared of erasing. Let me just color it and put a minus here. Vishwanath, sorry. The worst thing I can do. Anyway, into EK. So literally he was able to find a recurrence between one integral involving K and the other integral involving K plus one, the two integrals. So he was able to find a very elementary recurrence. Where does this solve our problem? Because En is actually our Selberg integral in the case of with an alpha plus one. So En is just the product of all TIs. So what has happened is when you multiply with the weight alpha becomes alpha plus one. And of course, E0 is your old Selberg integral only. So you got a nice recurrence, which in, so I'll write it down what that is.
What was that W, capital W?
Capital W, sorry. Oh, I should have defined it, but maybe I don't need to. This is the weight involving the Selberg weight. How do we put it? This whole function. I mean, this function.
Okay. W. That integrand.
Yeah, the integrand.
So you're taking the integrand, multiplying it by the kth elementary symmetric.
Exactly.
You still have the delta also.
The delta is also part of the integrand. Yeah. That's what gives it its. Otherwise, the elementary symmetric function would also. I'm not sure how the integrals go. I'm sure you probably know it well better if the delta wasn't around. But yeah, I'm going to ask some questions which might be intriguing. I want.
Oh, E0 is S. Okay, correct.
And E0 is S alpha beta. Nothing.
I don't and understand. EN alpha is, plus N perhaps, or is it alpha?
No, no. It's just there is a. So because.
Oh, N. Ah, that
is. There is a. It sorry. EN is T1, T2, etc. up to TN.
The K also, right?
You see. K is the order of the.
Yeah.
Sorry.
So I'm getting a bit confused now.
Sorry. K is the number of variables in your product.
It's a degree, yeah.
Degree. So if degree N, so you have T1, T2 to TN, there is only one option.
Oh,
so it's
oh,
just
oh,
the product.
It. Okay, okay.
And so that just goes into the weight, the alpha becomes alpha plus one.
Okay, okay.
Very clever. This is Evamoto's idea, not mine. And what's more important is how he proceeds after that. So instead of, so if you don't mind, I'll just erase this thing here. I'll just continue this. So by our recurrence, whatever we have got, so EK plus one, EN becomes related to EN minus one, becomes related to EN minus two, and so on, all the way up to EN zero. So what do we get finally? That alpha plus one beta gamma is actually equal to the original Selberg integral into a huge product. So these products actually cancel each other. I'll just write it down, but you can verify. It's easy to verify. So basically you have, I didn't have written this, alpha plus J gamma by alpha plus beta. What happened? Alpha plus beta plus n minus 1 j gamma. That's all. J goes from 0 to n minus 1. So you have a recurrence relation involving alpha plus 1 and alpha, and you repeat it several times to get to this stage. I'll write it down here. Sorry. More space. Sorry. Okay, here we go. Are we? S alpha plus m beta gamma is S alpha beta gamma into this huge sort of product. It's a gamma, a product of gamma functions, basically. Alpha plus m plus j gamma. And here it becomes alpha plus beta plus whatever it is, gamma by and alpha plus m plus beta plus, sorry, where that in the bracket it's just n minus 1 plus j comma. Just trying to save a little, whatever little time I have, by writing it down this way. How does it help us? Now this is the part where it becomes interesting. We use large, so it's easy from the integral to get this sort of estimate. It's alpha minus n beta n into n minus 1 comma as alpha goes to infinity in certain ways, whatever, in to the right or whatever you wish, as real alpha goes to infinity, whatever you wish to say. But the large large alpha asymptotics are as follows. Very easy to derive this from the integral. But it's also easy to derive from this Stirling's formula, where we get gamma of, let's just say, x plus a by gamma x is like x to the minus a, x to the a, sorry, it grows as x goes to infinity mod x, whatever you want to say, without that argument being in that in a certain cut plane, actually. This is Stirling's formula. In any case, for us, if we were to just assume that m is going to infinity, what would happen? So what we would conclude is that this term here and these products have the same asymptotic. I mean, if you include that as well as this, sorry, what am I doing? I'm so sorry. Uh-huh. Okay. So if we were to just focus on these things in the right and left, so they have the same asymptotics, and by analytic continuation, they also have the same poles and zeros, whatever you wish to say, poles, for example. So the ratio becomes a sort of bounded analytic function and therefore constant in terms of alpha. And this is a quick way of saying, so basically what one concludes is that that S alpha beta gamma would be a product of, again, gamma alpha plus J gamma by alpha plus beta, whatever was left behind, into some function involving only beta and gamma. So the alpha part we have eliminated. By symmetry, you include the beta part also. So there will be a beta term, and then it will be only a function of gamma, and you proceed along Selberg's line like we did earlier. So I hope that part was clear, or at least I indicated some sort of proof.
So you still use this Carlson's theorem after that?
No, there's no Carlson's theorem needed. Earlier, Carlson's theorem was because we knew all of that only for gamma being an integer. Here we have no such restriction on gamma. The recurrence that Aramoto derived was neutral. It's alpha, beta, gamma could be anything. And it was totally, I forgot to tell you, it's totally based on integration by parts. So it's elementary. And a lot of symmetry arguments. So what is the conclusion?
So is there a symmetry with gamma and alpha or beta? I mean,
no.
That's not so obvious from
me. No. It's just between alpha and beta.
Only between alpha and beta.
Only between alpha and beta.
So
gamma
how do you
has a special
gamma
phase. No. We handle it by the Selberg's argument. So Selberg arrived at that earlier also, right?
Oh, that.
If
okay,
you forget Carlson's theorem, he just had this recurrence, and again, the recurrence was only due to calculus. Freshman calculus would do.
Yeah.
Limits would do, and so that was the elementary nature of the proof. So what is this final thing that we got? So that's what I want to point out to you, that En was product n into n minus 1 n minus 2 plus 1 by k factorial. So I have to learn this from Amri or to practice. And then there is this product extra, alpha plus n minus a minus 1. I'm just going to, sorry, there's a, just this extra. You bet j doesn't go all the way, it stops at k minus 1. So just if you want to focus on ek, earlier the proof was how to find out the value of s. But once you know the value of s, you can back calculate and go up to ek. That's what I'm trying to point out. In ek, you need, just need k products and alpha plus beta, etc. 2n minus j minus p gamma. And then whatever is left is s alpha beta gamma. So this is the part which I wanted to bring to your notice. Not only me, then after seeing this very carefully, there was this mathematician called Cadell. Let me just write his name first. And his proof came out in 1997. But there's a bit of history there, and he seems to have been forgotten for his contribution with most people, even, okay. For most of this theory, I have referred to the review by Forrester and Ole Werner of the Selberg integral. They have a very major review of all the results connected with it and history, etc. I strongly recommend it. I have just taken bits and pieces from there. And from Forrester's book also, there's a separate book where he talked about its relation with log gases, Coulomb gases, random matrix theory, etc. Now, so they seem to mention that Cadell was the guy who proved it first, but the conjecture was known to MacDonald. So anyway, thanks to Vishwanath, I got MacDonald's paper also. And even MacDonald, in his famous book, the one on Hall polynomials, symmetric functions and Hall polynomials, 1995, even there he credits this to Cadell only. So, and even in the paper of 97, where he makes these conjectures, he explicitly mentions that these conjectures, there are five of them, are due to Stanley, Cadell, and myself. Now, going through all those conjectures, it seems that the only conjecture that was suitable for Cadell to make was this, which he proves finally in 97. His paper was submitted in 87 and accepted also in 87. So I really don't know how it took this long to get published. Okay. What's the result? The result is, if now I'm making this I, this is our subject of the talk, which is already like 40 minutes past. Sorry. I'll just be quick here. I'll try. Integral lambda 1 by gamma of t w. So instead of the element symmetric polynomial, we replace it. So even this is 0, 1 only. We replace it by this Jack polynomial. So this is the Jack polynomial, which I will have a lot to say about the Jack polynomial. With parameter, sorry, 1 by gamma. So I'll have a little bit more to say about it, but he replaces the elementary symmetric function by a very generic polynomial, symmetric polynomial, which almost interpolates between the elementary, the monomial, and the Schur function, everything in one shot. And he gets a very simple form for it. So let me just write it down and trying to remind you of the EK1. So it's again, I didn't tell you that, sorry. So the EK1, what was more important to see was that, this part is actually the value of EK at 1. When you put all 1s, you get this number to be the value. It's just n choose k. Now here, this is what he concludes. 1 by gamma of 1 to the n, all ones, and a variation of this. So let me just put it this way. Product. Okay, I'll write the product because it will take us too far afield to. No. I'll write the way in which it's currently mentioned. Gamma lambda gamma by alpha plus beta plus. So it's the version in the most generic case. So the generic value lambda. It's indexed by partitions of at most n parts. So I should have written all that, but yeah. And you still have your S alpha beta gamma. So it's, in some sense, he has studied the proof of Amato a lot, and of course of Selberg also, and done this. Seems to have been a very monumental work for him. Yeah, it took a lot of time in advances. And not to forget that MacDonald mentions his name several times in his book. This conjecture is due to Kettle, this identity is due to Kettle, etc. So it's probably a little neglected sort, I feel sad about that fact. Even when this people who are doing the review, if they say that the conjecture was known to MacDonald before Kettle, that was a little sad because it's clearly mentioned in MacDonald's paper also, 87, that maybe even the conjecture was due to Kettle. Okay. So what's special about this? So what, right now I will talk about a little about Jack polynomials, but before that I'll also write it in a different way, which might be useful for what I have to say. I mean, if any contribution from me, this is it probably.
So Krishna, gamma. It's the same gamma, is it? The gamma in your weight W is the same.
Yes.
Gamma which appears.
Yeah, that's the unfortunate part, that these two are linked, and I might question that in a bit, but it seems that it's, there's no way in which you can make this vary independently and still get a product formula of this sort. These are all product of gammas only.
No, I mean, I asked because your original formula with the E is, I mean, there's no gamma there, right? The E, that symmetric function, is independent of gamma. The gamma.
Yes, that's just a fluke. I'll just talk a little bit more about Jack polynomials before that. So maybe I'll ignore this and talk about Jack polynomials. We'll just, I'll understand the result first. Sorry. So what are Jack polynomials? Jack polynomials I suppose I'll have to talk a little bit about that, right? Unless the audience would be knowing beforehand. I'll just assume that you probably are seeing it for the first time. So first thing is, it's defined completely by the following two conditions. So p lambda alpha, so alpha is generally the variable written here, is we can express it in terms of the m lambdas, but it is like the matrix which the matrix expressing p lambda in the m lambdas is strictly is upper triangular with ones on the diagonals. This is the dominant ordering as before, and these are somewhat like your Costa Kortzka numbers. And if you have a scalar product where the p lambdas are the power sum functions, the products of, so p lambda is p lambda 1 into lambda 2, etc., and each p lambda 1 is the power sum function. If you had started out by just defining this inner product on the space of polynomials as delta mu lambda, of course, with this weight function. Where, of course, Z is the order of the stabilizer of the element of stabilizer of this cycle of a permutation with cycle type lambda, right? That's how we define Z lambda. I might be wrong here, but I've kind of forgotten. This is Z lambda. It's there in the theory of zonal polynomials also. But anyway, if you have not seen before, that's fine. I'll clarify that in a bit. But this is, if we start out with this scalar product where the p lambdas are orthogonal with the following weight function, sorry, weight quadratic term. P lambda with p lambda is this thing which depends on alpha. Then,
what is L lambda?
L lambda, oh, length of the permutation, length of the permutation. In our case,
non-zero parts of
lambda. The non-zero parts, number of non-zero parts.
Ah, okay, okay.
So then, so this is B, it's still continuing in, we are still in B. Then our P lambdas are orthogonal with respect to that. Is delta mu lambda into something. Oh, I shouldn't have written that. I don't have the theory here. We don't need to say anything. Is zero if mu not equal to lambda. This is how we define these two conditions, totally define p lambdas. So it's just that we can, it'll be defined up to a scalar bit.
You already have delta mu lambda up there, and now you're saying
no, this is the small power sums. I'm sorry, am I okay with that? Sorry.
Okay. So you're taking symmetric functions, but you also have this parameter alpha, right?
Yes.
And now you're taking ordinary power sums without any parameter.
See, the ordinary power sums without any parameter in polynomials, in the space of all polynomials, are supposed to be, are in, endowed with this scalar product, sorry, whatever product, inner product. And these are the numbers that turn up when find out the inner product of little p lambda with little p lambda. Once you have defined the inner product this way, find that one which is orthogonal and has this characteristic. So this is exactly a generalization of the Schur function. Schur functions have this when alpha is one.
But k lambda mu alpha, I thought that is
k lambda mu one are all positive integers in that case.
No, but k lambda mu alpha is supposed to be determined by the rest of the stuff, or is that something that's given?
No, it's not given. We are only saying that it has to be strictly upper triangular. I mean, it has to be upper triangular and once on the diagonal. For some. So I should have just said for some.
No, I've seen this definition several times. I never really quite felt it.
Indeed. And then McDonald made this conjecture that they are actually positive. I mean, they're polynomials in alpha with positive integral coefficient. Yeah. So that was like a big, tough one for people, but they have cracked it, right? Vishwanath, it's very advanced stuff. Pardon?
Is that the co-charge stuff?
That's one of the examples, but this I think is part of this general theory of McDonald polynomials. Parameters, Q and T.
Yeah, when you go to higher...
a certain special case of those.
So this is a special case of the McDonald polynomial when q is c to the alpha and then p tends to 1. So, but we'll not get into that. I'm just saying that these two are sufficient to determine it. If you wish, you could also have another inner product and say that it's orthogonal with respect to another inner product, which is of this following. Another inner product, which is the integral over the torus, n torus, which is S1 cross S1 cross S1, etc. In the complex space, UT, VT bar, of course, same delta T, but with the modulus, of course, by alpha. So this is a complex integral in over a torus, as in each one is a S1. If you have this inner product, then these guys are orthogonal with respect to this inner product also. So if you want, you could have replaced B with this. If you hate B, then you get down to this inner product. This is actually, yeah, those who are well aware, this is the constant term identity in a certain expression. This is how the constant term identity business starts or ends. Oh, I don't know, sorry. I'm not the expert here. This is another of those things. Surprisingly, this is not related to, I mean, when we replace this by 0, 1 to the n, all hell seems to break loose, as I am just pointing out. You gave me time from 2 to 4. How much of that time can I take? Sorry, MD.
Oh, did I? Okay.
Okay, fine. No problem. I'll try and my best to
it's okay.
Stop as fast as I can. I mean, I can stop at any stage, right? You will call me again. if you are interested and if others say they don't rebel.
No, you can always continue next week. So if you find a natural stopping point, then just feel free to stop and continue next week.
So then those, maybe I cannot, I will not talk about that. The main thing which I really wanted to talk about is this Q tableau coming up and the hook length formula. So maybe I could keep it for now. It's just not going to be possible in 10 minutes, 15 minutes. Let me just complete this first. This is the one, so I can ask some questions and stop maybe. Even these seem to be unknown to me. I'm not able to locate in literature. So let's just move to the next page. So with all that, you were asking this question about T lambda. T lambda of 1 of x was our familiar Schur polynomial, which is like, we know everything, right? A lambda plus the same old Schur polynomial who came up since long time, Schur's time. If you put alpha is 1, and if what if you put, so even the other case that Aramoto did was something that's kind of well known, and I'll just say whatever the lambda, whatever the alpha value, right? Whatever the alpha value of alpha, but if you had your 1 to the k, means 1, 1, 1, 1 as a partition, then it is actually the element 3 symmetric function. This is the capital P, by the way, sorry. Made it capital. But what do we know about other things? It's some sort of interpolation. So if you actually want to get to the value 0, if you could take the limits, etc., or even if maybe alpha, yeah, if you take the limiting condition case, then you do get E lambdas, means the product of lambda 1, E lambda 1 into E lambda 2, etc. And if you went to infinity somehow, this is the limiting case only, you would have gotten M lambda. It's a huge sort of interpolation. Of course, MacDonald introduced his polynomials and all this became like old hat. But during his time, the 87 paper this was all like new stuff. This was the advanced stuff. Kedel, for example, kept on defining what is called Selberg functions, Selberg polynomials, etc., and realized that it's just these things. So then in his published work, he called it Selberg-Jack functions. But anyway, they have all been like one big group. Stanley has definitely influenced all of these people. So in their papers, it becomes clear that they have all brought this theory up together. So there's also this other thing, right? So P lambda alpha of X is also a well-known over all the tableaus of shape lambda. It's a generalization of the stuffed horseshoe polynomial where WT alpha, so now this is, I couldn't locate it very clearly, but he claims, so I believe, it's explicitly given as a rational function in alpha. So literally like a products, a numerator and denominator being products of upper and lower hook lengths. So upper and lower hook lengths become something like this. So C lambda of alpha is a product over S in lambda, the arm length plus and the lower hook length, something like this. I might be wrong, but I'm not even looking at my notes right now. Sorry. One. So there's this small twist between the two. And McDonald himself is not clear which of them, I mean, he's not, he might be clear, but he's not mentioning explicitly which of them come in the numerator, which come in the denominator, etc. When alpha is one, this is all like, they're the same thing, and it comes boils down to what we already know about the Schur function. This is like something. There is a lot of theory there. Now, and even the evaluation at one will involve all these quantities. So I'll not get into it anymore. What I was trying to say is two things, right? So I can do two things. First is how to make how to evaluate the integral. So from what I could understand of Kedel's theory, it was this. So I, and then finally my contribution will be a determinantal approach, which you might laugh at. I want you to laugh at it. So first thing is, there's McDonald's, there is Stanley, sorry, Stanley has proved this. Over several variables, I is 1 to n and j is 1 to m. So I'll just not write it down. Alpha, right? Alpha? No, gamma. Okay. What I like to call it something else. Gamma is a sum over these things, these very things. This is Stanley's result. So I think the way in which Werner has quoted it, somehow something went wrong. It may not be in this terms, but let me just continue. He should have written it in terms of alpha. So I've got it from Werner's and Forrester's paper. I could not locate it yet. It's there in Stanley's work somewhere, sorry. So this product, this in the denominator, with a, when it's raised to one, you already knew that it was a sum over partitions of maximum n parts, the sum over lambda, which sum is four partitions maximum n parts. This term was just missing. When alpha was one, it's missing. And then you had S lambda X into S lambda Y. That was our old McDonald's identity, right? Or maybe it's Cauchy. Sorry, I have no idea who it belongs to, or Schur maybe. Sorry, but it's as a formal identity, it was known to many people. This is due to Stanley. And if you can specialize the value of Y, etc., what you get is this, which I really...
Squiggle to the left of the product, is that something?
Pardon?
There is a squiggle to the left of the product, is that anything?
Yes. Here.
No, something that looks like a cross between an S and a zeta.
This one? Sorry. This one. Oh, this I erased. Sorry. I'm scared to touch the eraser.
Then this is just Cauchy's or whatever's
identity. Cauchy's identity. You're right. Cauchy is the word.
Cauchy raised to gamma.
Cauchy raised to gamma. Exactly. So this is something new which Stanley produced, where the Jack polynomials come up. But you can definitely expand it in terms of other, like the elementary symmetric functions, if they come earlier in Cauchy's product, used to be E lambda and H lambda, right? The duals of each other in some inner product. This itself was an inner product of something. There's a lot of theory about it, but yeah, currently, let me just tell you, see what happens finally. I'll just tell you this later. Alpha? Oh, alpha. E lambda. Okay. So basically what he was somebody else, this is, wait, did I have to write it down? Stanley. And this is Yan. When was that? 94. It's quite recent. So Yan has, this is called Yan's binomial theorem in terms of Jack polynomials. But what is the interesting part? When x is, when a is a negative integer. Sorry. If a is negative integer, this is just like some another symmetric polynomial. And what you end up with is a finite sum. So it gives a finite sum. In particular, when a is 1, you get the sum over the EKs.
Do you mean negative 1?
Sorry, negative 1. Yes, yes, yes. A is negative 1. Exactly. Thanks. In particular, when A is negative 1, it becomes a sum over just the EKs where, due to the sum conditions. I'll not get into it, but I never defined this particular expression. This is the expression, this sort of expression is what we get in, I didn't define it earlier also. Let me define it right now. Lambda I, oh, I. The number of parts, so it's a sort of, this is something that goes down in multiples of gamma where you start, but this is the rising factorial in terms of lambda. Make sense? Or if you want, you could say this is a ratio of gamma functions. So A minus J minus 1 gamma plus lambda I by gamma of A minus J minus, sorry, J and this lambda J then. So it's a ratio of two gamma functions. Literally, whatever we have in all these things are products over gammas, or we have product of hook lengths. In any case, what was I going to say? Yeah. When A is a negative integer, somehow these conditions not only constrain the possible values of lambda, for the rest of them, they're like, you get singularities in the denominator and they just vanish. This is one formal way of looking at this binomial theorem. When A is minus 1 in particular, you get only those lambdas, which that is the 1 power k. There are only ones are allowed. That's what you get. So then, let me just tell you finally how we will prove. So we will start by writing alpha plus A beta gamma. So Selberg integral. We write it as, x to the, we write it as x to the a and w alpha beta comma t, maybe t, t. So whatever was there, we had an extra t to the a. Okay, I should not have written alpha.
Here you have a as an integer, right?
A, pardon? Yeah, I'm using a as a, okay. Okay, I'll just put a minus sign, thanks. I'll just, yes, a is a negative integer is what I had said, so I will stick to that.
Right, but t is a vector, right?
And t is a vector, so by that I just mean product of, okay, eraser, that's a bit ideal, sorry. Before I ruin this talk any further, let me just write everything down in neat fashion. Okay. Okay. Alpha, beta, minus a. Let me, for the time being, sorry, just write plus because I'm getting confused. Let's assume that a is an integer for now. You have understood the statement that it becomes a finite sum. At least I have made it clearer, hopefully. So here what I'm going to do is when I have alpha and beta plus one, for example, let's say a is one in your mind, then what do I do is I write it as a product ti power a. An additional a has come in. So I'm just writing it separately. One minus t. Because it's coming in the beta part, it's a one minus ti that I really wanted to handle. And that is the kind of stuff that our Jahn's theorem, binomial theorem, helps us to do. So we write it as a sum over certain lambdas, finite sum, and certain hook lengths and blah, blah, blah. I lambda of alpha, beta, gamma. Yeah. So what was the curious part is, whatever the value of A, it's only these coefficients that are affected. And the function that comes up is just the same with lambdas and alphas and et cetera. So this alpha, I should have just renamed it, but that's fine. So whatever it is, the Jack polynomial comes up. If we had chosen alpha to be 1 by gamma, then we could have related it to Kedel's integral. Why am I speaking so much? I'm trying to say that this problem, this expression gives, for example, in Ayamoto's case, it was just b plus 1. Beta plus one, and you were having some sort of simple sum over the EKs. Of course, it's another matter that we found Ayamoto found a recurrence between EK plus one and EK so that we could just reduce this total sum into one term because each of them are related to each other. So basically, we took out all the common factors and then left it there. Here, what we will do is we will do no such thing. I mean, in theory, we will write this as a system. We, assuming that the left-hand side values are all known to us already by the Selberg integral, this becomes an over-determined system. So it's almost like the way in which the Schur polynomials themselves or the Jack polynomials themselves have been defined. You can easily use the same sort of system to define or derive the values of. So it's a basically linear algebra problem which. If you will trust me now, it can be solved. There is enough variables, sorry, there are enough equations and fewer variables that we will be able to solve for them and hopefully get the answer. So that is the one place where I can say I don't want to say I can stop. Another way was this, my own method, which was coming from number theory. So I start with a determinantal approach, dx dy, for ij varying from 0 to n minus 1. So it's an n cross n matrix. Each element is an integral. Of course, such integrals, but without the denominator, have been seen in the theory of Selberg integrals. So Richards and Zeng themselves have some such integrals. Unfortunately, the one with this has not been seen, fortunately or unfortunately, it's not been seen so far. What I can do is, without spending too much time, because I have already overshot, I'll just tell you that I can express it in terms of, okay. How do I move it? Okay, I'll not even try to move it. So I express it in two ways. The first way is that I write a I in each variable. And then what do we do with such things? The each row is like a limit of sums, etc. So the sums, the integrals come out. Each xi is, comes out, and each yi also comes out. And we get a determinant of this inner quantity. So literally, it's a product xi power I, because it comes out of each row. And 1 minus xi by yi, determinant of yi to the j, dx dy. So we get it, we write determinant as some sort of big integral, and then several nice symmetric manipulations later, we arrive at this conclusion. This is actually, whatever this integral, delta x square delta y square. It would have been interesting to see it, maybe for next time. Product, so it's a nice and beautiful symmetric function, of course, 1 by n factorial square comes out. So it looks like this, but here we have our Cauchy's identity to our rescue. You can write it as a sum over several things. So basically, it becomes a sum over lambda. Integral s lambda x delta x square dx, and the same thing for y also with an n factorial also. So on one side we have this, on the other side, if we were to expand it, this expand this this integrand 1 by 1 minus xi yi into its power series, let's say summation over ki, xi to the ki, yi to the ki. This denominator we expand and then becomes a sum, therefore. So the sum we can integrate, etc. And then pull out the sum, etc. And do several more similar manipulations later. It's almost the same, actually. It's a way to explain it in a nice way. So again, it becomes kn. K1, and let me just make sure it's bigger than that. What do we get here? We get delta of, so in this particular case, it's another, let me just write down. Several manipulations later, it's extremely almost mirroring whatever we did here. If you do it in mirroring for the sums and use a Cauchy determinant again, sorry, the same determinant which we had to evaluate here, and so on. It's a lot of work, but we compare these two now. So this is the part at which I was saying that you will see my contribution. It's not even a proof, but I would say that now when we read out, here it is partitions with at most n parts. And here it is strictly increasing partitions with n parts. So basically what we conclude, sorry, I am laughing, you should be laughing actually, that lambda plus delta. So what is delta, by the way, I never mentioned. Delta is this usual n minus 1, n minus 2, 0, the famous staircase partition. This is the same delta which comes here also. And I'm saying that actually the best way to make it into a proof would be to put in a lot of Q terms here and there. That will lead us too far into this McDonald polynomials or at least Hall Littlewood symmetric function. So I'm not getting in there. I'm just saying that let's just assume that such an expression already implies that this has to be equal to this. So we just conclude therefore that S lambda delta x squared. So in this particular case, alpha is 1 or gamma is 1. Gamma is 1. Alpha is 1, beta is 1, so those terms don't come up only. All we have is this Dirac polynomial at alpha being 1, gamma being 1, sorry. And we conclude that this is actually equal to n factorial k or lambda plus delta over rho. Sorry, lambda I plus j. There's no square, sorry, there's no square. There was a square on both sides and we had to take the square root. There's a square here, there's a square here, there's no square here. Unfortunately, I didn't write that expression earlier, but this is exactly what we get by Kadel's integral also. On the face of it, it doesn't look the same, but the way Kadel himself wrote his expression. So here it is, Kadel's theory, Kadel formula. Yeah, here it is. So Kadel's integral was of this sort. And I was about to write the other expression, but this is exactly what you see below for gamma being 1. So it looks quite simple and straightforward, very easy to do. But what happens? So this is, again, let's assume that Kadel already knew the proof, so we are not getting anything new. We don't need to waste our time. But what happens when we change here, instead of I and j here, we begin to vary our stuff. For example, even if we take 1 minus x to the I, what you end up with is something really intriguing. So in the first place, so you get two things. One is s lambda. I'm just fixing my attention to, so you get integrals which involve products of Schur polynomials, Dirac polynomials if you wish. And this gives you a nice product formula. Let me just write it down here. Nice product formula. Symmetric in lambda and mu and all that. Here, S lambda x, S mu 1 minus x. In some sense, this is the most natural thing one could have done. Because you are earlier dealing with x to the alpha minus 1 and 1 minus x to the beta minus 1. So literally you are dealing with partitions of constant things. Alpha was your partition. Alpha minus 1 was your partition in one side. And here it was for 1 minus x, it was the beta. That partition was what you were dealing with. This is the kind of most natural generalization of your Selberg integral. If I have made my case here, I'll say no nice formula. It's actually a determinant. It is related to, I'll just put it here, ki plus mu j factorial. It's related to this. This is a factor coming up here. So this is what I was going to sing pains to and say, look, this is the number of number of standard Young tableau of shape something, Q shape, and there was no expected nice product formula because generally it's not going to be a product of hook lengths. what does that imply? It implies that whatever we were saying till now are actually products of hook lengths. What are the partitions that are involved, and what's the partition that's involved here? All of this I still have to talk about. Finally, I was going to conjecture the existence of some hook length formulas. That comes when you expand this in terms of M lambda and this in terms of M, I mean, sorry, expand this, both of them in terms of M lambda. So when you have M lambdas here, somehow you expect to get nice product formulas. Similarly for E lambdas. Why, I will again, hand wave only, so you're not missing anything. So if you were to expand them in terms of those other things, you'll get a sum over nice product. That's what I was trying to say in the maybe next talk some other time. Not next week, sorry. I'll prepare more properly, sorry. Any questions?
So this integral here, it's a product of two Cauchy alternands, right?
Which one? Here above?
No, sorry. S lambda into delta is a Cauchy alternand. S mu into delta is also a Cauchy alternand.
Why did you say Cauchy alternand?
It's a determinant.
But there's a delta square.
Yeah, so each one takes a delta and then you have a product.
Oh, here. Yeah. Product of determinant. Okay, fine. Yes.
So that maybe wouldn't that
one
help?
Reason.
Is this?
No, I'm expecting it to happen for all of gamma and I have miserably failed. I still hope that the gamma will come in and we will still have some slight modifications here only. It will still be a determinant. So, of course, when you say that this product of determinant is fine, but when you have a real gamma, that situation changes. But it doesn't seem to change the formulas any which way. So, for example, you just look at the hook. I mean, when I wanted to express that all of these things are actually hook length formulas of certain partitions, whatever you have seen till now, nice products, they're all hook length for any value of gamma actually. So then we would like to interpret what we mean by those partitions. Some real numbers thrown in.
So that last bit, have you written it up somewhere where we can look at it?
Give me some more time.
Okay.
Okay, written it up. Yeah, I can write it up and send it across. Yes. Whatever I have a supposed to say. Yes.
Yeah. Independent of everything, it looks like a nice little calculation.
Sure.
So, yeah, are there any questions?
Yeah, what are the constant term identities?
So, constant term identities to when Vishwanath is here in the audience, how can I speak? Vishwanath, please.
No. You, from your point of view.
From my point of view, array, this is like... Sorry. Anyway, this itself, this expression here, is supposed to be the constant term in some sort of expansion. Am I right, Vishwanath? Sorry.
Yeah.
And delta is a product of 1 minus Ti by Tj 2 by alpha. At least when alpha, 1 by alpha is a positive integer, this is gamma basically, right, gamma. Then, and there's a constant also here, this is Cn, which is related to some other conjecture, Dyson's conjecture, but whatever you get, this is the constant term in this identity. The Rasch-Laurent series in TIs. And if you just take out the constant term, whatever you get is this. And there was some conjectures made by some. There were several conjectures made by McDonald where this product is not over some simple, is related to Lie algebras and group systems. And yeah, they have all been solved, sorry. But it's very nice theory. He's written a book also on it. Cherednik has also written a book on it. But it's all very, very worthy theory. What I was referring to with McDonald's conjectures was about, I mean, there are several more conjectures he made about K lambda mu alpha in very general context. And those took a longer time to prove, especially the fact that they have to be positive integers. The polynomial was still okay, but positive integer coefficients was very tough.
This Ti by Tj, I is greater than j.
I less, whatever you want. You can decide what you want to do. I was taking I less than j.
Okay.
But finally, there's a modulus, right? So when you integrate them, it doesn't really matter which order you do it in. Sorry. Did I answer your question?
Yeah,
I didn't answer it because I don't know much about this.
Any other questions?
So just to complete, I haven't seen much of this literature, even where single products are involved. And McDonald, for example, wanted to know the entire theory of like a Littlewood Richardson coefficient. Sorry, if you take a product over p lambda and p mu and expand it in terms of p nu, what are the coefficients that would come up? So without integrating three polynomials together, I don't think you can answer it. But I have not seen a single paper where there are three polynomials. Two has come up recently in these are all coming in conformal field theory. How they do the calculations, but somehow what I explicitly asked has not been done. Both of these questions have not been addressed by those papers. There's one even in 2020, but yeah, sorry, where am I? These two are not addressed.
I mean, when you say the top one, you say it already has this nice
formula. Okay, it has a nice formula. Has it been addressed? Yeah, it has been addressed in that 2020 valor. So where beta equal to gamma they take. Uh-huh. So what happens in general beta case? I'm sure I can write down some product formula. I'll write it down and send it across to you people.
What is this 2020 that you're talking about?
It's a paper by Warner. Hey, this year, sorry.
By Warner?
And our collaborators.
Okay.
But it is based on a paper from physicists in conformal field theory, where they do try two polynomials with a certain shift, actually. So I'm not very sure if all possibilities they have been covered. This has never been covered. I have not seen it in the paper.
So this putting 1 minus x in place of x, you mean?
Yes.
That
seems to somehow give the combinatorial connection that I was referring to. I missed.
This is entirely new, you mean? This last thing is...
I cannot see anything in literature which says that. Stanley himself had an interpretation for Selberg integral in combinatorial terms. So it was the number of partitions of... n plus n choose 2 into gamma, where gamma, alpha, beta, gamma are all integers of certain symbols which satisfy certain condition. But he couldn't prove it. That was his question. It was part of some paper where he had bijective problems. So find a nice combinatorial proof of this. The only proof that he knew of were analytical of this sort, Selberg integral, using Selberg. Again, 2020, May 2020, somebody has put up on archive a combinatorial proof. It's on archive. It's called HOP. The person's name is. I will probably put everything down in the notes and some text.
So I'm seeing a paper called.
By whom?
AFLT type again.
AFLT is that.
Lanes and one.
Exactly. AFLT is a conformal field theory physicist paper. And there they have this plus beta by gamma minus 1. That's what they have here. In our case, gamma is 1, beta is 1, so this is gone. So whatever they have found is indeed nice product formula. So somehow in physics literature, which I could not produce much, they seem to be on the lookout for nice product means product of gamma functions only. So who knows, they have encountered this and then thrown it off because they didn't like it. And okay, this is the part that I have definitely to talk about, this whole determinant. So okay, it was a sum over several things, but I have enough reason to believe that it itself is a product. This integral is a nice product formula in terms of gamma function. That's the amazing part, that this determinant itself, or this integral, if you like, this integral itself is a product over gamma functions. But when you put S lambda and S mu, you don't expect, I don't expect any product, nice product formulas, but it could be having combinatorial interpretation. All later. But this has a nice product formula, is what coming from conformal field theory again. Calculations in, sorry. Yeah, I've taken too long. I'm so sorry. Apologize to the rest of the audience. If you are recording, I'm sorry to the ones who are watching.
So, yeah, are there any more questions? And, would the speaker like to make any more self-deprecatory remarks?
I thought you people will laugh, but I spoke too fast or left it to the end, I think. So that this is equal to this. Therefore,
it was a very nice lecture.
Okay, sorry. Thank you.
You apologize too much.
So how can it be that this is equal to this? Therefore, I mean, I have been laughing at it myself, but it seems to answer all the known integrals and giving some unknown results also. So there is something to it.
Okay, so let's thank Krishnan. You can unmute your mic and clap. And that brings us to the end of this seminar. I'll stop the recording now.